and our hope. To thee do we cry, poor banished children of Eve. To thee do we send up our sighs, mourning and weeping in this valley of tears. Turn then, most gracious advocate, thine eyes of mercy towards us, and after this our exile, show unto us the blessed fruit of thy womb, Jesus. O clement, O loving, O sweet Virgin Mary, pray for us, O Holy Mother of God, that we may be made worthy of the promises of Christ. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Good morning, everybody, and thanks for coming. The sentiments of the Murray family are with you. And I'm going to address you today to celebrate the life of Don Murray. Don Murray was often referred to as Pop-Pop, the Charmer, Uncle Don, and all that he was for sure. To me, Don Murray was the man. If I had to describe Don Murray, I'd start with a large portion of John Wayne, a little bit of Marshall Dillon from Gunsmoke, and a whole lot of the best-dressed Cary Grant. Don Murray was a tall, handsome Irishman who was always impeccably dressed. Admittedly, he was stunning. He was a voracious reader. He was a heck of a crossword player and was always in hot pursuit of his Irish genealogy. Possessing a keen sense of humor and wit, he was to me the perfect father-in-law. There was such fun being with the family in Buffalo. Don loved golf and fishing on his boat, Donnie's Buoy, or on the pier at Morehead City. He was happy at the beach or at parties or even across the kitchen table. Truly a gregarious person. He commanded a room and was always a presence wherever he was. He was the man. Don Murray was a devout Catholic. His faith guided him, and he was a good man. Leading by example, he bore witness to a life of faith. He was a patriot. Serving in the army, he fought the Battle of Juarez, and he continued his life of public service, serving 23 years in J. Edgar Hoover's FBI as Special Agent Murray. Afterwards, he served the community of North Carolina as the first director of ALE, Alcohol Law Enforcement. He held that position for 12 years. And in that capacity, he was the man. Don Murray's love was fierce. The boy from the south side of Buffalo married his high school sweetheart, the love of his wife, Maureen Downing. Mother Murray, as she was affectionately called, and Don were married for an impressive 54 years until her passing in 2010. Their union produced two sons and three daughters, two daughters-in-law and three handsome and talented sons-in-law, followed by 12 grandchildren and four great-grandchildren. His impressive legacy continues. He was the man. Don had the great good fortune later in life to meet Carol Leonel, his lady friend, and he were best friends and shared a very special love. Carol left us too soon, but the relationship stands as a testimony to triumph of friendship over loneliness. Don Murray was kind and generous. He and Maureen would arrange family vacations every summer at their condo in Moorhead, and as the families grew, the number topped 30. And so there were multiple houses at Myrtle Beach or Atlantic Beach. All the grandkids adored Pop-Pop. He was always fun and loving. Don Murray never turned away a hug or a good story. Truly kind, he was the man. Don and Maureen never abandoned their roots. They gave generously to the church and multiple charities. Christmas presents and birthday presents in the family were legendary. They cared for those who needed help, always had a helping hand, and a kind and loving voice. He was the man. So to all, so to all you old men out there, and you know who you are, the young men and the boys that will and the boys that will be men, I challenge you with the following. Be joyful, God-fearing and patriotic. Be loving, kind, generous. Be the man.
Please stand and direct your attention to the entrance of the church. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
In the waters of baptism, Don died with Christ, and rose with him to new life. May he now share with him eternal glory. Let us pray. O God, who have set a limit to this present life so as to open up an entry into eternity, we humbly beseech you that by the grace of your mercy, you may command the name of your servant Don to be inscribed in the book of life. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated as we now listen to the word of God.
A reading from the Book of Lamentations. My soul is deprived of peace. I have forgotten what happiness is. I tell myself my future is lost, all that I hoped for from the Lord. The thought of my homeless poverty is wormwood and gall. Remembering it over and over leaves my soul downcast within me. But I will call this to mind as my reason to have hope. The favors of the Lord are not exhausted. His mercies are not spent. They are renewed each morning. So great is his faithfulness. My portion is the Lord, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. Good is the Lord to one who waits for him, to the soul that seeks him. It is good to hope in silence for the saving help of the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Mm-hmm. The Lord is my light and my salvation. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom should I fear? The Lord is my life's refuge. Of whom should I be afraid? The Lord is my light and my salvation. One thing I ask of the Lord, this I seek, to dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, that I may gaze on the loveliness of the Lord and contemplate his temple. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Hear, O Lord, the sound of my call. Have pity on me and answer me. Your presence, O Lord, I seek. Hide not your face from me. The Lord is my light and my salvation. I believe that I shall see the bounty of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord with courage. Be stout-hearted and wait for the Lord. The Lord is my light and my salvation.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, no one lives for oneself, and no one dies for oneself. For if we live, we live for the Lord. And if we die, we die for the Lord. So then, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. For this is why Christ died and came to life, that he might be Lord of both the dead and living. Why then do you judge your brother? Or you, why do you look down on your brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bend before me, and every tongue give praise to God. So then, each of us shall give an accounting of himself to God, the word of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Believes in me, even if he dies, will never die. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he had sat down, the disciples came to him. He began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the land. And blessed are they who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the clean of heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the children of God. Blessed are they who are persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they when they insult you and persecute you and utter every kind of evil against you falsely because of me. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward will be great in heaven. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
On behalf of Don's family, we thank all of you for joining us this morning as we celebrate his life. And what we do today is by no means an easy thing, saying goodbye to a father, to a grandfather, someone who's always been there. And it's one thing to say, well, yes, he lived a nice long life of 94 years, but it's kind of like that 200-year-old oak tree that's always been there, that's provided shade and image of strength and a commanding image, all of a sudden is gone, taken down. And so we come here with very mixed emotions today, but mainly with the emotion of gratitude and thanks to God. And so that's why we're gathered here today. I feel that I have to, for the sake of those that are not Catholic or visiting us for the first time, I have to explain why is all of our images covered in red cloth. I assure you it's not because the Wolfpack won last night at the basketball tournament. So I've been accused of that. That happened because on the fifth Sunday of Lent, the church asks us to cover up our sacred images with red cloth. And so when we did it last Sunday, someone walked in and said, "Father, you have no shame," because the Wolfpack won the ACC tournament for the first time in 37 years. That's not why we have these cloths up. It is to remind us that a week from today, we will celebrate Good Friday, the day that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ offered himself up for us to take upon our sins and our death on himself. And so it is a time for us to cover away and to just focus more on Christ and get away from the different distractions that we have. Imagine if we knew that a family member or loved one only had a week to live, and next Friday at 3 o'clock, they would die. They would go home to the Lord. We're gonna fold up. We're gonna put off all, you know, turn our phones to off. We're gonna not be watching, you know, anything on TV or anything like that. We're gonna be focusing on our loved one. And as Christians, that's what we do in this last week as we enter into Holy Week. We focus on these mysteries so that when we come to Easter, we can celebrate in that joy. And what we do today is we are celebrating Don's life, but also giving thanks to God for giving the world Don in the first place. He was born in Buffalo, New York in August of 1929, nearly 100 years ago. At the time, what we call it the Great Depression, but it was something about the people that grew up in that particular environment. Imagine being in Buffalo with, you know, the very harsh and severe winters and all, and everyone is affected by the unemployment and the bad economy. People galvanized and took care of one another, and family was everything. And Don was an only child, but as only God could construct, he takes an only child and places in his path a woman that he would marry, who was one of seven. And he would be with her for 55 years. And bringing these two people together, they would produce a family. But also they would show that that fidelity of married love by putting God at the center of everything. And so it was part of being part of that greatest generation that he would go on to serve in the United States Army for 2 years, and then had just a phenomenal career with the FBI, and then helping the ALE, the Alcohol and Liquor Enforcement here in North Carolina, and doing all sorts of things to help others. But he was also a natural and born leader. He was just a commanding man, as you know. He was, you know, very large in stature and everything, but he was also larger than life, and not an ounce of arrogance. He had that self-confidence and that pride, but also great humility because of his deep Catholic faith and love for God. He would pray the rosary every day, very religious man, deeply devoted to the Blessed Mother, and he began each day by doing a 10-minute litany of reciting the names of people who had died. Now, you're talking about a man that lived for 94 years, and so that his list is a lot longer than ours. And look at the changes he's seen in his lifetime, going from Bing Crosby and Hoagy Carmichael to Lady Gaga, from Amelia Earhart to John Glenn and Neil Armstrong, to where we see about transatlantic flights and everything, to all of a sudden people of his generation being those engineers and scientists that put a man on the moon. And they did so with slide rules back then in the Mercury program. We didn't have these high-fangled computers that we have today. But it was people like of Don's era that were saying, why not? Why not? And so he saw all sorts of improvements and things, and he embraced technology. He didn't cling to the past, you know, in ways that certain sometimes we're immune to change. And that is the irony of his Irish roots. As Irish, we want to remember things for 1,000 years, particularly our grudges. But when it comes to embracing new technology, we would want to, you know, cling to the things of the past. But Don was able to do both. Honor the genealogy of where his family came from, and knowing that he wasn't just here by happenstance, but he goes all the way back to Adam and Eve. Just like when we see in Luke's gospel, the genealogy of Jesus goes from Joseph all the way back to Adam. Now, it's not a perfect and complete genealogy, but it's very symbolic, reminding us that we are all connected together. And then when our ancestors were dispersed to different continents and everything, and you get to the point where there's nearly 8 billion people on the planet, two people would meet in high school and fall in love and one day say in a church, I do to one another and I don't to everyone else in the world. And God would use them as co-creators to bring forth children into the world. And Don loved his children tremendously, and his 11 grandchildren and 4 great-grandchildren, very proud of them, and always wanted to just be there and available to them to listen, even if it was just to listen, not to just give advice or anything like that, but just to be that rock, to be able to listen to them. And that's the sad thing, when someone like that now is not a part of our life anymore. When you would go to visit Don, it was, I remember one of the last times I saw him in his little apartment there. It was beautiful how things were. It was just looked like a regular home, and this guy hasn't been able to see in quite a while, but he was still surrounded by these homey things. And when you went to see him, you made sure that it wasn't just a 20-minute visit, then you didn't schedule anything after that the rest of the day, because he held court. One of the last times I tried to see him was when he was in Rex Hospital. I believe he had pneumonia or something, but he was there with some breathing issues. And I'm standing outside his door for 30 minutes, just waiting. And he's there with the technicians and everything. And he's just sitting there talking and telling stories and everything. And they're just, you know, I know they had other patients to see and everything. But he, like I said, it was not an arrogant thing, but he loved being around people. And that's why you hear things that he was in the Toastmasters, something you don't hear much of anymore, but it gives people that kind of confidence to be able to speak in front of strangers and speak in front of others. And so Don, when in his work, he would speak out on behalf of those that did not have a voice. It was particularly the ALE agents that didn't have the same benefits and the same, you know, kind of perks as everyone else might have, because they were seen more as a fringe group. Or when you're in the FBI, there's all sorts of competing jurisdictions. There's the local sheriff maybe, and then there's others that are there. And he would be able to bridge that, to say, to get people to realize we're all after the same thing. We all want to protect society, but we all want to get down to the truth. And we want to make sure that crime scenes and stuff like that are not tampered with, or they're not compromised. But also he looked at the professionals there. And to be that extreme professional where you treat everybody fairly, even if you had to discipline somebody, they will take it well, knowing that, yes, I deserve this because He is a fair person. He's not playing any favorites. He saw the greater picture, the larger picture, and that's what made him such a great FBI agent, but also in his work with the ALE, that he saw that we were all members of a team. There is no competition. There shouldn't be this kind of rivalry, but he did speak out for those that did not have a voice. He was very quick-witted, great sense of humor. I would like to think that was from his Irish roots, but he was still one of those ones, a guy that was just a pleasure to be around. Not a complaining soul or anything like that, but just one that had a great perspective on life, perhaps because of his harsh beginnings. Being born in that era of the Great Depression, and then when he and his peers would be in the military, some would go to Korea. And that's one of the first wars that they call the Forgotten War. Whereas our troops, when they came back from World War II, were greeted to parades and all this kind of stuff. Well, the guys in Korea were just kind of forgotten about. Maybe because they were so far away and everything, but they endured such great suffering. And it was guys of Don's generation that did that. And when they came back, they made America what it is. And like I said, he's seen a lot of change, most for the good, but he's also seen a lot of things that aren't so good. And that's why we have to have that that knowledge of history. And he was very much a student of history, not just his own, you know, genealogy or his you know, ancestral roots, but also just knowing that if we don't know history, we're going to be doomed to repeat it. And so there's certain things that we don't just throw out with the bathwater. Well, that was the United States 2.0. We've since moved on from that. And so he was part of that great generation to be able to integrate love for God, love for family, and love for his work and all that he did. It is very hard to replace somebody like that, but there was a job description that Don applied for a long time ago, and he finally got the response. And it is yes. And that job description read, Jesus told his disciples to sit down, and there was a huge crowd of people there. And he said, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And retirement benefits are out of this world. But it didn't say blessed are the poor. There's nothing blessed about being materially poor. It can be, you know, a liberating thing when we don't have to worry about, you know, being possessed by our possessions. But it is those that are poor in spirit that have to rely on God for each and everything, even our very next breath. We should never take for granted. We need to thank God for that. Blessed are they who mourn, for they will be comforted. And in 94 years, you're going to say goodbye to a lot of people, your parents, your wife, Maureen, another faithful companion that gave Don a good quality of life, and also the entertainers, the sports figures, the friends. When you get to live long enough, you start to feel more and more isolated because the people from your day and age, there's a lot less Perry Como's and Bing Crosby's and a lot more Lady Gaga's and Taylor Swift's around that maybe you can't quite identify with. But he did a lot of mourning, but he also did a lot of rejoicing, remembering the dead and praying for them by name daily. Who will do that? Who will take up that baton to remember them, to honor and cherish their memory? Because we're all part of God's family. And then when we hear, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the land. No one is going to put on their resume those first three things. I'm poor in spirit, I mourn, I'm meek. Next, you're gonna just throw your application in the garbage, and they want someone that's gonna be aggressive, that's a go-getter, that's looking for the bottom line, that's gonna help the company. But Jesus is saying, no, we're looking for the opposite. And so Don was able to support his family and do things for them, but also to be an important part of a federal institution, but also looking at the needs of the local level. Those agents that still were trying to send their kids to good schools and try to put good food on their table and maybe didn't have access to health insurance and all that other kind of stuff that others might have. He was looking for always doing the right thing. And so this application became irresistible. When we read on further down,
Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Again, he was a man of fairness. He wasn't a man that played favorites. Blessed are the clean of heart, for they will see God. His little corny jokes and everything, when his daughters came in the other day, the things that they would, you know, say, you know, some of his, you know, certain sayings and stuff like that, are just fun. His sense of humor and his great wit, but also his delivery, because he wanted to lighten the burden of others. He wanted to share joy and to share mirth. We forget that side of Jesus, that Jesus was a joyful man and a mirthy man, but sometimes we have this image of him as just being so holier than thou and so unapproachable. But to be fully human is to be able to laugh and to make others laugh, and Don was able to do that. And then one of the more difficult Beatitudes, when we hear, blessed are they who are persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. We hear terms now in our day and age in our great country like deep state or the swamp and this and that, and it can kind of put a stain on certain institutions, like maybe the FBI, even the military, people have issues and stuff like that. But we must remember, these are men and women that swore an oath to protect us all, and Don was a great part of that, and he has passed on seeds that we can't see, but God does, about how he would train his replacement and all of that. But then the last beatitude, blessed are you when they insult you and persecute you and utter every kind of evil against you falsely because of me. Rejoice and be glad. I assure you, it's never been easy to be Catholic, especially here in the South. He came here to Raleigh and to Our Lady of Lourdes Parish in 1965. I was born 4 years prior to that in Winston-Salem, and we were 1% Catholic at the time. My daddy said when they moved here from the West Coast to Winston-Salem in 1954, they would see signs in North Carolina, help wanted, Catholics and Irish need not apply. Well, we don't see those signs up anymore, thankfully. And, you know, there's been a lot of changes, a lot for the good. I remember my sister, when she was born in the late 40s, when she moved to North Carolina, when they would see, you know, the water fountain, it would say colored. They said, oh, gee. And they pushed the button, and they were disappointed. That looks like regular water. They were expecting it to be like strawberry or grape-colored water, but they didn't realize that it was a segregated place where not everyone had that kind of access. And so Don was born into a culture where there was separation. But then they lived through that, particularly by soldiers and agents and police realizing we have to be together, we have to be one. Even though we look different, we think different, we pray to God different, we cannot have these distinctions. And it was people of Don's generation and him himself that saw the beauty and dignity of everybody. And so he saw a lot of changes for the good, but we must honor their memory to try to keep doing what he would do, to build that team attitude, to be able to look at each other as a deeply needed person in the organization, but more importantly in God's kingdom. And so Don grew up with this job description of every good Christian, of the Beatitudes, and he prayed every day, and one day we will have to leave this world, and it is something that we might not necessarily look forward to, we might not understand, but God created us to be with him for all eternity in heaven. And so Don's life began early in the year of 1929 in the safest place possible inside of his mother's womb. And she didn't even know that he was there. And he grew and grew, and then all of a sudden, maybe his mother started to have symptoms or realize, oh, something's different. And then there'd be a time where she would realize that there's a child there, not knowing if it's gonna be a boy or a girl, but with great anticipation, but knowing that in good time, that child will be born. And that child has no concept that it has a loving mother and father. So close to the mother, physically inside the mother, But one day, Don's life was literally turned upside down, and the solitude that he was experiencing, the darkness, is now replaced with a blinding light, and the warm water that surrounded him is replaced by cold air on his skin once he comes forth. And to top it off, someone grabs him by the ankle, swats him on the bottom, and says, "Welcome to Buffalo." But once they clean you up and now place you in the arms of your mother, game changer. And so now he's still in this world, but in a very different fashion, not realizing the whole time this much in front of his little nose in the womb was this beautiful world that we want to hold on to so much but don't want to leave. But then we are here not just to make a good name for ourselves or to have a good 401k or to have buildings or places named after us, but it is to develop our souls so that we can be with God for all eternity, because God is love. And that's why God sent his son Jesus Christ into the world, so that we might see him clearly, love him dearly, and to follow him wherever it would lead us, to follow him nearly. And so one day, Don's life was turned upside down. All of the illnesses and stuff that he was able to fight off for 94 years laid claim to his human weakness. And he went forth home. And leaving the womb of this world, imagine now, he's been deprived of his sight for many years. Imagine seeing, the first thing you see is that face of Jesus Christ. Many times we think we go to heaven, we're going to see our wife or our ex-spouse or our parents or siblings, and we're going to continue on our earthly life here. We kind of forget the whole purpose of things. It is God himself. And so when God had Don by the hand, he said, "Come to me, all you who are thirsty and are burdened, and I will refresh you." And Don took that hand. And so today we're helping our brother to journey home and to remind ourselves that one day where our brother Don is gone, we shall also follow. But after we see this world, not for a minute do we want to go back to the darkness and solitude of the womb, so that saints in heaven would not want to come back here unless only to tell us this one thing: there is a God, he does exist, and he loves you very much. And so what we do today is, like I said, by no means an easy thing, saying goodbye to someone who's always been there for us. But he will not just live on in our memories and our fond remembrances. He is part of that body of Christ. He's just gone on to another womb, a room that God wants us to be in. And Jesus, on his last night on earth, was trying to explain to his disciples the scandal of the cross that he would experience the very next day. And he said that in my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. And so I'm going to prepare a place for you, and when I do, I will come back and bring you to myself, so that where I am, you also may be. Well, remember when our Lord went home to the Father, he wasn't 94 or 450 or 600 like Noah, 33 in the prime of his life. Tom Brady would milk out another dozen years, you know, doing what he did by that, but Jesus was only 33. And so many times when we lose somebody that was dear to us, or certainly before their time, we might get angry with God. We might say, "Why did God do this?" And so we are here in this world for a very brief time to make a splash, to make a difference. And Lord knows that Don Murray made a huge difference in everyone's lives, or even a little difference in people's lives. I know those two nurses at Rex Hospital, they have a different appreciation for the elderly. They realize that they are full of stories. They are full of joy. One of the last things I'll say is kind of funny to me. His daughters were saying the other day that when Father Kenneth went and gave him the sacrament of anointing of the sick, which we get from the letter of James, chapter 5, "Are there any sick among you? Send for the priests of the church and let the priests pray over them with oil, anointing them with oil." And so Father Kenneth went and said these prayers over him. And people many times might call it the last rites, but after that, Don said, "I just had the most wonderful funeral." Well, it wasn't his funeral, but we pray to God today that he will say to the Father, I had a wonderful funeral today because all of my friends, my family were here. Even those that can't physically be with us today are somehow connected to that. You can't be around a guy like Don Murray and forget, what was his name? Larger than life. And so he has gone home to where God has always wanted him to be, and now we are left behind to try to embrace that technology, but remember the good, remember the potential that we have to improve the place or the work environment that we're in, but particularly our families. What many people don't have is someone just to listen to them. People are always full of advice for one another, but Don, as an Irishman, he knew when to be quiet. He sure did know when to speak, but he made his words count. But many times, it's just that presence of being with someone else. And so we give back to God what he freely gave to the world, and let us realize that just this far in front of our face, if we could take a spiritual scalpel and cut it open, is heaven. God and the angels and saints, but like that baby in the womb after 3 months of gestation, we're not ready for that. We got to stay here until God says we're ready and he calls us home as he did our brother Don. But if there was any stain of sin or selfishness that clung to our brother, we ask that in God's infinite mercy, it be wiped away. May his soul and the souls of all the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace. Amen.
Please stand. Brothers and sisters, Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and sits at the right hand of the Father, where he intercedes for his church. Confident that God hears the voices of those who trust in the Lord Jesus, we join our prayers to his.
For John, who in baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, that he may now be admitted to the company of the saints, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Our brother Don was nourished at the table of the Savior. Welcome into the halls of the heavenly banquet. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the family and friends of Don, who seek comfort and consolation, heal their pain and dispel the darkness and doubt that come with grief, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the many friends and members of our families who have gone before us and await the kingdom, grant them an everlasting home with your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have fallen asleep in the hope of rising again, that they may see God face to face, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of us assembled here to worship in faith, that we may be gathered again in God's kingdom, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer, Jesus Christ, and the voices of your people, whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ, and grant them a place in the kingdom. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated as we now prepare our gifts.
Oh.
stand. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and of all the Holy Church.
Be near, O Lord, we pray, to your servant Don, on whose funeral day we offer you the sacrifice of conciliation, so that should any stain of sin have clung to him, or any human fault have affected him, it may by your loving gift be forgiven and wiped away through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord.
Either kneel or sit as you are able. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you gave life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me.
The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Luis Rafael, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Remember your servant Don, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who is united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages and praise you without end, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow in the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Stand. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, power, and glory are yours.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
Thank you.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. For the reception of Holy Communion, we invite those Catholics that wish to receive to come up the center aisle to receive the body of Christ. If you're not Catholic but would like to receive a blessing, you're invited to come forward with your arms folded across your chest in the sign that you would like to receive a blessing.
Take and drink, take.
Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that your servant Don, who has journeyed from this world, may by the sacrifice be cleansed and freed from sin, and so receive the everlasting joys of the resurrection through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again, when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother Don to the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon Don in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and with you and with our brother forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Go into the peace of Christ.
Immediately after Mass, we have a reception in our social hall in the Fallon Center, so you're all invited to join us. But when we leave the church, we'll stop here outside for military honors, and then we'll accompany our brother to the hearse, but then we'll be meeting with the family at the reception immediately afterwards. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Snare of the fowler will never capture you, and famine.